The recording. Good afternoon, all of you. Today we will see measure of shape. In that we will be emphasizing on skewness and kurtosis. So let's start with one example. Calculate mean, median, mode, standard deviation, variance, standard error, coefficient of variation for the following data. You can see the data is available on your screen. And you are also required to plot frequency distribution curve. Okay, so x value and corresponding frequency is given to you. 7 observed for 0 times, 9 observed for 1 time, 11 observed for 3 times, and so on. So this data point is given to you. Now we will start one by one with mean, median, mode, and so on. So in order to calculate the mean value, we need another row, that is the product of f and x. So you can see the product of 7 and 0 is 0, 9 into 1 is 9, 11 multiplied by 3 is 33, 13 into 4 is 52, and so on. So this is how we multiplied the value of x and corresponding value of f and completed third row. So we got row of fx. Now we know that mean for the given type of data is summation fx divided by summation f. So when you add all the values corresponding to summation or values corresponding to f, the answer will be 35, and that is summation f. Similarly, we will sum all the values corresponding to fx, that third row that we prepared, and that answer will be 595. So when we take that ratio, you will get mean as 17. So for given data points, the value of mean is 17. Now we will move ahead, and we prepared another row, that is fx square. So 0 into 7 square, 0. 1 into 9 square, 81. 3 into 11 square, 363. 4 into 13 square, 676, and so on. So this is how we can prepare a fourth row for fx square. And that particular row is essential for calculating standard deviation. So we know that standard deviation is equal to square root of summation fx square divided by n upon minus mu square. So we already prepared a row for fx square, and just sum all the values available in that row, you will get summation fx square. So you can see the sum is 10,635. Here n is nothing but summation of x, and that we already calculated. So n is 35. Then mu is nothing but a mean, and its value we just calculated. So put the value of mu as 17 square. And when you simplify this equation, you will get standard deviation as 3.8545. Then we know that when we take the square of standard deviation, it will become a variance. So this is how you can take the square of standard deviation, 3.8545 square, and the answer for variance is 14.8572. In reverse order, if we calculate variance, just take its square root, you will get standard deviation. So vice versa, we can use that formula. Then we know the formula for coefficient of variation. So it is equal to CV is equal to sigma, that is standard deviation. This is standard, not variation. This is standard deviation. Okay. Standard deviation. Okay. So sigma we calculated 3.8545. Put its value. The mean value could be positive or maybe negative. So we will take its mod. So it's 17. We already calculated, multiplied by 100. And upon simplification, you will get coefficient of variation as 22.67. So here, what we did, we calculated mean. We calculated standard deviation. This is standard deviation actually. Then we calculated variance. Then we calculated coefficient of variation. Then we will move ahead. So we know that in order to calculate median, we need to prepare another row for LTCF. LTCF means less than cumulative frequency. In previous classes we discussed. And in the problem, the value of x and value of f are given to you. So the first value will be 0 as it is. Then 0 plus 1, answer is 1. 1 plus 3, 4. 4 plus 4, 8. 8 plus 6, 14. 14 plus 7, 21. 21 plus 6, 27. 27 plus 4, 31. 31 plus 3, 34. 34 plus 1, 35. And 35 plus 0, 35. So this is how we prepare an additional row, that is third row, for less than cumulative frequency that is required for calculating median. And we already calculated the value of summation f. So this summation f, if it is odd, then what we need to do, we need to look out the class corresponding to which cumulative frequency is greater than or less than or equal to n plus 1 upon 2 for the first time. And that corresponding value of x will be a median. So very important thing. Maybe from this statement you will not understand. So I made it very simple. So first of all, you will take summation f, and the answer is 35. So this summation f is 35, means it is odd. Then what we need to do, we need to find out the value n plus 1 upon 2. So n plus 1 upon 2, n means summation f, which is 35. 35 plus 1 upon 2, the answer is 18. Now we got summation f and n plus 1 upon 2. Now we need to go back to the table, and in table what we need to see, the class we need to identify the class corresponding to which cumulative frequency is greater than n plus 1 upon 2 for the first time. So we got 18. So you can see between 14 and 21, the value 18 is there. So we understood that the cumulative frequency for 14 and 21, between which the n plus 1 upon 2 is there. Now what we need to do, we need to check the cumulative frequency greater than or equal to. So we got 18. So next or greater value is 21. And for this cumulative frequency, the corresponding value of x is 17. So our median will be 17. So this is how we calculate median. Briefly, I will tell you once again. We calculate summation f, which is odd in this case, as it is 35. Then we calculate n plus 1 upon 2, which is 18. For 18, we need to check which is a greater cumulative frequency. So we need to go to row number 3, and 21 is greater than 18. So we identified that cumulative frequency. And for 21, the value of x is, corresponding value of x is 17. So this 17 will be your median. So this is how we calculate the median. Then we need to calculate the mode. So mode is defined to be the value that occurs with the greatest frequency. So we need to find out the frequency, the value of frequency which occurs maximum time. So you can see here in this second row, the maximum value of f is 7 and corresponding value of x is 17. So you can say that the mode is 17. So this is how you can find out the mode as well. Again, the formula for standard error, we know that it is standard deviation upon square root of n. N means summation f. So standard deviation is 3.8545. Summation f, that is n, is 35. Upon simplification, you will get standard error SE as 0.6515. So this is how we can calculate all the required values. Now we will understand how it is important from practical point of view, because we are also required to plot frequency distribution curve, as we already calculated mean, median, mode and so on. Now we will try to plot. So you can see here the original given data, which is with us, x and corresponding f. Now by using these two rows, we will draw a frequency distribution curve. So you can see here, in this particular, we will try to understand how we plotted this. So on y-axis, you can see frequency, means second row. On x-axis, we plotted the value of x, that is values corresponding to x. So in the table, the first data point is 7, 0. So you can see 7, 0. So when x is 7, the frequency is 0. Second data point is 9, 1. When x is 9, you will get frequency as 1. Third data point is 11, 3. When x is 11, you will get frequency as 3. You can see here. Then next point is 13, 4. So when x is 13, you will see frequency as 4. You can see here. Yes, you can map it. Similarly, 15, 6, this one, 17, 7, 19, 6, 21, 4, 23, 3, 25, 1, and 27, 0. So this is how we can just plot a bars corresponding to the frequency. And once you plot all the data points, this will be your frequency distribution curve. And when we look at this curve carefully, and if you try to convert this into a curve, then you can see that it is like a distribution curve. And shape, you can see, you might have seen this type of curve, that is a red color curve, somewhere. So this is called as frequency distribution curve. And why it is called as frequency distribution curve? Because under this curve, all the data points and how they are spread over axis x and corresponding frequency, you can visualize. And that's why we plot this curve. So frequency distribution curve will help you to understand the distribution of the data. graphically, because if only this table is with you, you will not understand anything, or you can understand but difficult to understand. But if you plot a corresponding curve, you can easily visualize how the data is spread over x-axis and the corresponding frequency. Now we will move ahead and we will try to understand what do you mean by mean, mode, median. So first value is mean. We already calculated the answer is 17. So here you can see 17. So mean will be here, exactly at the middle or to very close to the middle. So this is the graphical understanding of this mean. Standard deviation is 3.8545. So what we will do, we will take mean plus standard deviation and we will check. So 17 plus 3.85, very close to 21. Similarly, mean minus standard deviation, the answer is 17 minus 3.85, which is close to 13. Then mean plus 2 sigma. So answer is very close to 24. Mean minus 2 sigma, the answer is very close to 10. Mean plus 3 sigma, which is close to 28. Mean minus 3 sigma, which is close to 6. So what we did, we used the value of mean and standard deviation and we draw some vertical lines for mu plus sigma, minus sigma, plus 2 sigma, minus sigma, and so on. Now again you can see a curve, that is frequency distribution. Now see, mu minus 3 sigma to mu plus 3 sigma, so totally it is 6 sigma, mu plus 6 sigma. And many a times you heard about the 6 sigma curve, and that curve is very similar to this type of curve. So this is the actual meaning of the curve 6 sigma, which we talk many a times. So 6 sigma curves, it is a frequency distribution curve. And why we are particularly interested in 6 sigma, mu minus 3 sigma and mu plus 3 sigma, that is total 6 sigma. Why we are interested? Because all the data points are between this 6 sigma. You will see rarely a point from this table which lies outside mu plus 3 sigma and mu minus 3 sigma. So these are the boundaries for the data point. And 99.99% data points will be between this 6 sigma. This is the practical significance of this 6 sigma curve, or importance of mean and standard deviation. Now we will move ahead. We know that the square of standard deviation means variance. So variance, you can see. Median is 17. So again, you can see the median is also there. So mean and median are at the same point. Mode is also 17. So mode is also there. So we can say that mean, mode and median are exactly at the same point. And that's why you can see about this particular vertical line, the curve is nearly symmetrical. You can easily guess from this distribution. And to have this symmetrical distribution, what is requirement? Mean, median and mode should be at the same point, and in this case it is at 17. Then we also calculate standard error and coefficient of variation as well. Now we understood how to draw a frequency distribution curve. We understand mean, mode, median, but in this particular case the curve is symmetrical and mean, mode and median are at the same time. But the question, every time it is true? The answer is no. And now we will try to evaluate which are the different shapes of this frequency distribution. So we will try to evaluate the same. So first is very parallel to this data, we will see another curve. Yes. What we did instead of these bars, so we just draw a curve. So the curve may look like this red color line. And I'm saying here area equal to 1 means all the data points fall within this curve. This is the upper limit and this is the lower limit. Between upper and lower limit, all the data points will be there. So area under the curve will be 1. And you can also see that about this vertical line, this blue colored vertical line, the curve is symmetrical. So 50% data points on the left side of that straight line and 50% data points will be on the right side of the data point. And here mean, mode and median are at the same point or same vertical line. And that's why we call this as a symmetric distribution, because about this vertical line, the curve is symmetrical. So symmetric distribution. And this is very popular shape of frequency distribution. Just like we call it as a Six Sigma curve or bell shaped curve. So whenever we say bell shaped curve or Six Sigma curve, we are referring to this symmetric distribution curve. And I will tell you, when there are thousands or millions of data points are there, then you will see symmetric distribution. For example, we will take one mechanical engineering example. For example, you have a CNC machine, and on that machine you want to manufacture a shaft of 20 millimeter diameter, and per day you have to manufacture 10,000 such shafts. So every time you will not get exact 20 millimeter. Sometime you will get 20.1 millimeter, sometime you will get 20.2 millimeter, 19.9 millimeter, 19.85 millimeter. So a lot of variation will be there. So manufacturing, whenever we say manufacturing system, variation will always be there. And if you want to plot that variation for thousands and millions of shaft sizes, then you will get a curve just like this or very close to this curve. And based on our standard deviation, so plus 3 sigma and minus 3 sigma. So most of the data points will fall in the 6 sigma, that is plus 3 sigma and minus 3 sigma. If your manufacturing system providing the shaft diameters which are above the upper limit or below the lower limit, then it is an indication of there is a problem in the manufacturing system. So such type of curve will help you if there is any problem in the manufacturing system or not. Such type of understanding we can develop. Okay, so we will move ahead. So this is the first case called as symmetric distribution, and it is very popular. But as I mentioned, every time you will not get this type of curve. You may get skewed distribution. So what is that? I will tell you. First of all, we will go through this theory. So a distribution which is not symmetrical, it is called as skewed distribution. So from definition we can understand it is not symmetric distribution. Now there should be some cases, right? So the first skewed distribution is called as positive skewness or positively skewed distribution. Now we will take some same data, different data, but x and f are same. And when we plot its frequency distribution, then you will get this type of frequency distribution curve. 0, 0 corresponding to first data point, 10, 15, second, 20, 30, this one, 30, 25, you will see next bar, 40, 20, next bar, and similarly, you can plot all the bars in the frequency distribution curve. Okay, but this is not the previous case, this is the new data points. X and F have different data points. When we look at the frequency distribution, you can see most of the data points are at the beginning of the curve. So this is the beginning point, right? And at the beginning, most of the data points are there. You can see here, most of the data points at the beginning. So you can see, if you want to draw a curve, then you may draw like this curve. So what we can understood from this, data is concentrated at the beginning and there is a long tail on the right side. So that's why this curve is called as positively skewed distribution, or it is a positive skewness. Whenever we say positive skewness or positively skewed distribution, data will be concentrated at the beginning and there will be a long tail towards the right. Or like this, you can say maximum concentration will be at the beginning and a long tail will be on the right side. So this is called as positively skewed distribution. And when we calculate the mean, median, and mode for such type of data, then you can see mean is greater than median, and which is greater than mode. So we can say that mean is greater than median and then mode. So this sequence you will observe when it is a positively skewed distribution. So that understanding is very important. So suppose you don't have a curve, and if you have only mean, median, and mode values, and if mean is greater than median, median is greater than mode, if this is the case, without a graph, you can say that it is a positively skewed distribution. That conclusion we can make. Again, we will go to the next case, that is a negative skewness or negatively skewed distribution. And we took another data set and we plot the data points. So 0, 0, first data point, you can see 0, 0, 10, 1, 10, 1, and so on. We can plot the data point that we already discussed. Now, when we look at this data set, then a frequency distribution may be like this. And what we can see here, that data is concentrated in this particular region and there is a long tail towards the left. This is the long tail. So whenever we observe long tail towards left and data concentration towards right, then we can conclude that it is negatively skewed distribution or negative skewness. Now, graphically, you can observe this type of curve. Now, in this case, important observation is mean has a least value, median has a median value, and mode has a maximum value. So you can see the sequence. The sequence is mean is less than median, median is less than mode. So if you don't have such type of curves, and if you have only mean, median, and mode, these value, and if mean is less than median, median is less than mode, then without a graph, we can say that it is a negatively skewed distribution. So this is how we can understand the skewness. But we will take example and we will try to understand how to read this curve. Because we can easily understand, if there is a long tail towards left and data concentration towards right, it is a negatively skewed distribution. Or take other case, if data is concentrated towards left and long tail towards right, we can say it is positively skewed distribution. But practically, how we can draw interpretation? Let's say X is marks. So generally the exam that we give, it is of 100 marks. And let's say we divide into small, small intervals. 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 up to 100. So we divided the 0 to 100 range into different segments. And we observed that there are 0 students who received 0 marks. There are 10 students who received, I told you in opposite way. 0 students received 0 marks. 15 students received 10 marks. Corresponding bar you can see. 30 students received 20 marks, so this particular bar. 25 students received 30 marks, so that is here. 20 students received 40 marks, and so on. So that distribution is there. So we are correlating with number of students and how many marks they received. And we plotted this particular frequency distribution. So what we can understood that there are many students who received less than 40 marks. So we know that if we received less than 40 marks means we fail in that subject. And there are so many students. So you can see 20 plus 25 plus 30 plus 15. So many students who failed in that examination. So what we can conclude? The question paper was tough. Can we draw? Yes, we can draw this conclusion. Many students are failing in their particular exam means question paper was tough. Now, this is another case, and this example is very closely related to the online examinations. So what we are observing in online examination, many students are scoring greater than 60. So you can see the data is concentrated here. Many a times you will see a long bar right here, right? So what this means, students are scoring very good marks in the examination, especially in the case of online examination system. That is, data is concentrated towards right and long tail is towards left. So what we can conclude from this, that either question papers are very easy, right? Because students are getting very good marks. Means question paper is very easy. That one conclusion we can draw. Second conclusion could be, as the examinations are in online mode, and that's why students are getting a chance to copy the to check what is the answer either in the books or on the internet, and that's why they can easily get the answers from internet or books, and they are just entering the answer. They are not solving the problem and then putting the answer into the answer sheet. So that observation we can draw. And why I have taken this examination, this particular examination, because in real life, in online examination mode, we are observing this. And this is a big problem. You are getting good marks, is absolutely fine. But on other side, you are not solving the problems. Means, you are not developing your skills how to solve a problem. These skills are somewhere missing. That observation we can draw from this. Then this is a big loss for you, right? Because you are not developing your problem solving skills. As a faculty, what is learning from us, learning for us is that we know that there is a chance that student can copy the answer from online or book. So we need to set a question paper in such a way that students will not get answer online or in the books directly. Yes, they can get the formulas how to solve the problem, but they will not get exact answer. So if we as a faculty, if we understand this philosophy that we should set a question paper in such a way that student will not get answer in the online mode or in books, then we can get a distribution like this. So that just a minute. Yes. So if we set a question paper like this, what will happen? The students who are very clever in problem solving, they will get very good marks. Student who didn't prepare for the course, they will get less marks or they will fail in the examination. And students who are average skills of problem solving, they will be at the middle. So this is how we need to plan. We will go back again. Yeah, here. So the students who put a good effort in the course and solved as many problems in the practice session, then definitely they will get good marks. So they will be here at higher end. Students who are not interested in a particular course or who didn't put a effort to solve many problems in the practice session, definitely they will get less marks, so they will fail the exam. And students who are average, that they solved medium problems and they are practicing, but they are not putting huge effort, so they will be at the middle. So this particular curve we can use for setting the question paper, understanding the distribution of the students, weak learner, medium learner, or fast learner. So this is the practical significance of the data. Now we will move ahead and we will try to understand measures of skewness. So from previous examples, what we understand, this is negatively skewed data and this is positively skewed data, but we want to quantify the degree of skewness. So that's why we need to come up with the formula through which we can measure the degree of skewness. So that we will see now. So there is no typical mathematical derivation or formula for calculating the measures of skewness. So we will rely more on the mean, mode, and median values, because that sequence we saw here, if negative skewness is there, mean is less than median, median is less than mode. In positive, what we saw, mean is greater than median and median is greater than mode, that we know. And that we can use to define the measures of skewness. And there is an empirical relationship between mean, mode, and median. And that relation is, if we take the difference between the mean and mode, and that is very close to 3 into bracket mean minus median. So this is an empirical relation based on a lot of data analysis and experience. This particular relation has developed. Now, in order to calculate the degree of skewness, or it is also called as coefficient of skewness or Pearsonian coefficient of skewness, which is developed by Carl Pearson. And that is one of the major of skewness, and it is denoted by SK. And this is the formula. So SKP is mean minus mode upon standard deviation. So mean minus mode upon standard deviation. And generally, the value of SKP lies between minus 1 and 1 in most of the cases. And for moderately skewed distribution, see, there are two cases you need to understand. If it is extremely skewed, for example, like this, if this is the extreme distribution, right? So you need to go to this particular formula. But if it is moderately, for example, it looks symmetrical, but it is not symmetrical. It is skewed, but it is a moderately skewed distribution. And if you are dealing with moderately skewed distribution, you need to use this formula. SKP is equal to 3 into mean minus median divided by standard deviation. So extreme distribution, Karl Pearson coefficient of skewness is preferred, or this particular formula is preferred. And if moderately skewness, then it is, this formula is also derived by Karl Pearson, and you need to rely on this particular formula. Now, if distribution is symmetrical, that is Six Sigma curve, we saw this like this, then in that case you will get SKP equal to 0. If negatively skewed distribution is there, then SKP will be negative. Okay. And if positively skewed distribution is there, then SKP is positive. So from the value of SKP, if you don't have curve, if you don't know the relationship between mean, median and mode, then only the use of SKP or Karl Pearson's coefficient of skewness you can use to understand what type of distribution is there. If SKP is equal to 0, you can see that, say that distribution is symmetric. If SKP is negative, then negatively skewed distribution. If SKP is positive, you can see that positively skewed distribution will be there. So this is how you can make use of this value, SKP value, to understand what type of distribution it is. You need not to remember, draw the every time the curve, and from that you need to judge. Only this value will help you what type of distribution it is. One more, we will take one example, okay, in this case, to understand in more detail. So what is the example? Mode is larger than mean by 4.5 times and variance is 121. Compute coefficient of skewness. So when we look at the data, we don't understand whether it is symmetric distribution, it is positively skewed distribution or negatively skewed distribution. But we have the relationship between mean and mode, and we have variance. So given that mode is larger than mean by 4.5, so first equation we can derive, mode is equal to mean plus 4.5, variance 121, which is given. So the difference, we can rewrite this formula, right? Mu minus mode is equal to minus 4.5. And from variance, you can calculate standard deviation. So it is 11, square root of 121 is standard deviation. Then if we know mean, mode and standard deviation, we can calculate coefficient of skewness by using Pearson's formula. And that formula is here, mean minus mode upon standard deviation. So put these values. So mean minus mode is minus 4.5. Sigma, standard deviation is 11, we just calculated, and answer is minus 0.4091. So the value of coefficient of skewness is negative, we can say that it is a negatively skewed distribution, and the degree of skewness is -0.04091. So in this example, we understand that even though we don't have curve or data points, only with the help of coefficient of skewness, we can find out what type of distribution it is. And here in this case, it is negatively skewed distribution. That conclusion we can draw. One more formula is there for calculating coefficient of skewness, and which is developed by Bowley. Okay, so you can pronounce in a different way, that is fine. So it is called as Bowley's coefficient of skewness, which is derived by scientist Bowley. Okay, and it is denoted by SKB, B for Bowley. And this is the formula for that. SKB is equal to Q3 minus median minus median minus Q1 divided by Q3 minus median plus median minus Q1. Just there is a change in sign. Rest of the formula is same. And upon simplification, you will get a formula like this. Now you may ask here, sir, we understood what is median, but we don't know what is Q1, Q2 or Q3 here. Q1 and Q3 are there. So we'll understand what is Q1 and Q3. So basically they are quartiles. Q1 means first quartile, Q2 means second quartile, and Q3 means third quartile. But we will see what is that mean. But this particular formula we will use to find out coefficient of skewness. And again, in this case also, the value lies between -1 to 1. And when SKB is greater than 0, we say positively skewed distribution. SKB is less than 0, we can say it is negatively skewed distribution. When SKB is 0, it is a symmetric distribution. So it is just like the previous example, previous method. So from this we can easily conclude. So if value is positive, positively distribution. If value is negative, negative distribution. If it is 0, symmetric distribution. Again, in this case, we don't need to know the data points or the distribution shape. Only from the values, that is coefficients, we can easily predict what type of distribution it is. Of course, one more thing, of course, there is slight deviation could be, because in case of Carl Pearson coefficient, we relied on mean, mode and standard deviation. One approach is there. Or we can also rely on mean, median and standard deviation. And in case of Bowley's method, we rely on median as well as Q1 and Q3, that is quartile. Now we will see what is Q1, Q2 and Q3. So before we start, I will start from complications and then I will go to a simplified way. So the sample 25 percentile is called as first quartile, that is Q1. Sample 50 percentile is called the sample median or second quartile, that is Q2. The sample 75 percentile is called as third quartile, that is Q3. You may say, sir, we don't understand. We will take another example. The quartile breaks the data into four parts. Roughly 25% of data being less than first quartile means below first quartile, 25% data points will be there. 25% being between first and second quartile. So between Q1 and Q2, 25% data will be there. And 25% data will be between the second and third quarter. That is between Q2 and Q3, 25% data points will be there. And last 25% data will be above quartile 3. Still you may say, sir, we don't understand. Simple. You can easily understand from this figure. First quartile Q1 is there. And below this, out of all data, 25% data will be there. This is median or Q2. This is also called as Q2. So between the Q1 and Q2, 25% data will be there. Between Q2 and Q3, 25% data will be there. And above quartile 3, that is Q3, remaining 25% data will be there. So whether it is symmetrical distribution, it is positively skewed or negatively skewed, we can calculate Q1, Q2 and Q3 by using this formula. So for calculating Q1, you need to use this formula, 1 upon 4 n plus 1th term. Q2, you can use this formula, and for Q3, this is not Q2, this is Q3. So use this formula to calculate Q1, use this formula to calculate Q3, and use this formula for calculating Q2. So this is my mistake, so this should be Q3. Okay, clear. Or graphically, you can see here, between this region, nearly 25% data is there. So you can see this is the borderline and called as Q1, and this is quartile 1. Now, here, this particular line, I will draw one additional line here as well. So this will be your Q2. Don't look at anywhere, just look at what I'm saying. This is Q2. And when we look at the region between Q1 and Q2, I will take a different color. Yes. So you can see here the region. This is not a good color. I will take black color. Okay. So look at this region. So between Q1 and Q2, 25% data will be there. Again, between Q2 and Q3, you can see here, 25% data will be there. And above Q3, remaining nearly 25% data will be there. So this is how we can understand Six Sigma concept. Also, quartile Q1, Q2 and Q3. So this is how we need to understand. And this is the distance difference between a Q3 and Q1 is also called as interquartile range or IQR. Any notation you can use. But this particular concept is very, very important. Now we will move ahead. This particular example is very good for symmetric distribution. Now this is positively skewed distribution. And here you can see that the difference between Q1 and Q2 is very small. And the distance between Q2 and Q3 is large, because of the shape of this distribution. Let's take another case. If data is negatively skewed, then the difference between Q1 and Q2 is very wide compared with Q2 and Q3. So this is how we can understand the degree of skewness from the values of q1, q2 and q3. This is also called as box plot, right? We are going to see how to draw a box plot, but this particular examples, example 1, example 2 and example 3, these three examples will help you to understand the concept of skewness as well as how to identify the type of distribution, positively skewed, negatively skewed or symmetric, by using quartiles. Okay, now we will move to kurtosis. So the last point is kurtosis for today's session. So kurtosis refers to the degree of flatness or peakness in the region about mode of the frequency curve. So first of all, we will draw a frequency curve. We will find out where is mode, and we will check the curve is flat or it is peak at the mode. And based on that, we will decide the degree of or kurtosis. The degree of flatness or peakedness depends on less or more dispersion. So we know that the frequency curve will tell you about spread of the data. So let's take three curves, curve A, curve B and curve C. All the data sets are symmetric. So you can see if we draw a vertical line at the middle, then it is a symmetric distribution. But again, in symmetric, there are three cases, A, B and C. So A, you can call it as a leptokurtic, B, you can call it as a mesokurtic, and C, you can call it as a platykurtic. So we will see, we will start with mesokurtic. Such curves are neither peaked or nor flat topped. So you can see about mode, the mode, mean and median will be here. So when we look at the shape which is close to the mode, then it is neither peaked or flat topped. And for such type of curve, the kurtosis can be taken as zero. So for mesokurtic, the degree of kurtosis is zero. Let's take platykurtic, so case C. So you can see in this case, the curve very close to mode, then you can see that it is more flat topped than the normal curve. If we compare with B, it is flat topped. See, so this is very flat surface, right? And because of that, it is called as platykurtic. So just like a plate. It has a broad central closure and lower tails. Now go to next case, lepokurtic. So you can see very close to mode, there is a peakness or peakedness. So that's why this is called as leptokurtic. The observations are more closely bunched around the mode and have positive kurtosis. So what we can understand from this, when we say mesokurtic, the degree of kurtosis is nearly zero. And in case of platykurtic, the surface close to mode is nearly flat, or we can see that degree of the negative kurtosis. And when we talk about case A, that is leptokurtic, the data is concentrated near the mode. So you can consider this area, region. So data is concentrated very close to mode. And that's why it is called as positive kurtosis. And in each case, you can understand that द वैल्यू ऑफ स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन इज डिफरेंट फॉर केस ए केस बी केस सी मीन इज सेम फॉर ऑल द थ्री केसेस मीन इज सेम बट स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन इज डिफरेंट दिस पार्ट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सो फॉर डेटा सेट ए डेटा सेट बी एंड डेटा सेट सी वी कैनॉट रिलाय ऑन मीन वैल्यू वी नीड टू रिलाय मोर ऑन स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन बिकॉज फॉर केस ए standard deviation value will be very small for case b standard deviation will be moderate value and for case c the standard deviation value will be very large so this is another example where we can easily guess or try to understand on which value we should rely more so that's it from my side for today's session if you have any question the session is open for discussion